Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back for the second half of the session. I would request at the delegates who are outside to please join us in. We'll be starting in next 2 minutes. This is not required. Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome back. So the next session is going to be in a format of panel discussion. And I have two, three questions which I will share with them. Before that, I would like to invite upon stage the panelists for today afternoon. First of all, Mr. Mukesh Mehta, CTO of Batliwala and Karani Securities India Private Limited. Can we have a round of applause, please? Sandeep Karan, CIO, L&T and Technology Services. Sunil Kankal, seasoned CIO and IT consultant. Mr. PVJ Prasad, CIO, Hafael, India. Mr. Venugopalan, Director, Security Engineering Checkpoint. Mr. Arjit Mitra, CIO, Noida Power Company. I have a small request to delegates. We have some empty chairs here. This is going to be more of a Q&A session. So if you could join us in the front seats, which are vacant. And if you are not comfortable asking questions on mic, please write it down on the notepad which is there on the table, along with your name and company, and share it with me over here. So this session is focused on infrastructure for digital, wherein I would like to take the opinion of the esteemed delegates on the cloud, new age data centers, and hyper-converged infrastructure. First of all, warm welcome to all of you. And I will.
Mics are ready, right?
So we'll start from this end and we'll take it to that. I have three questions. You can choose which one to answer. So I have kept it slightly broader, covering all the three topics that I just mentioned. So one is like how cloud has changed the entire IT infrastructure and what is the roadmap ahead. Second, what is your data center strategy, if you're into it? Your views on HCI. I will also request if you could give some case studies or your personal experience or some implementation that you have done, which would be very much useful for the audience over here as a takeaway going forward. So once they are done with their replies, I will open the floor for Q&A. So we can start now. Thank you. Yes, Mr. Venugopal, please, you can start.
Thank you, Mr. Prashant. My views on cloud security, I'm going back to security, as you can imagine. We're talking of cloud, but then, you know, security is what we do. Given the amount of born in the cloud companies that we see today, one of the most important aspects is, you know, what part of security in the cloud is something that the infrastructure, cloud infrastructure provider takes care of, and what part of security is the responsibility of the customer. And that's, I think, a very pertinent question that is running in the minds of everybody. Given the amount of product development that happens in the cloud, I can tell you that the days of, you know, having an IT governance in place for software development lifecycle, all that is more or less vanishing with the cloud-based approach. What we are also seeing is, given the agile development model, customers or application providers or product vendors are beginning to build apps in 15 days, right? They have to have a release every 15 days, which makes sure that the agility is there in place. Now, if we have to go through a governance model to push that code onto the cloud, the whole aspect of agility of the cloud is gone for a toss. What this also brings to the picture is the fact that when people are writing code, doing multiple rounds of testing on it, and then pushing it to the cloud, what are the aspects that they have to keep in mind when the eventual movement to the cloud happens? And the amount of APIs that are available on the cloud today, they could all be misused. Right? So cloud, I think, is a boon and a bane, like anything else. And given the adoption that we see of data centers moving to the cloud, there is also a need to also look at the secure aspect of the cloud. That's my first views on this topic.
Good evening, and thank you for this opportunity. I would like to take the second question that he asked about the cloud adoption and future of cloud. I think, cloud is not new to any of us, any one of us. We use cloud in our day-to-day lives every day. Everything is on the cloud, right from your mobile applications that you use to the email, everything. But the evolution of cloud has defined new paradigms altogether. When it started, it was only cloud, public cloud. So there was a lot of resistance from the enterprises to adopt because nobody knew about the security concerns. Because everywhere, till such time, till the adoption of cloud, people were keeping the data close to their hearts. So they will not let go out of it. So as the security concerns were addressed and looking at the flexibilities that cloud offers, the adoption increased, and now we have various flavors of cloud, private, public, hybrid. So these terms also evolved based on the needs of the enterprises. Those who does not want to become completely public, then the terminology private cloud came up, which gave the flexibility of having an on-premise and on-cloud options. So enterprises had the choice of choosing what applications to move. And in a way, to the IT guys, it gave them a more leeway to explain or convince the management that you can let go of your non-core applications so that the maintenance, the support, and the speed at which these applications dynamically keep changing. So to manage that infrastructure in-house was becoming a challenge. So enterprises also started to understand this and tried to adopt this private cloud option, or hybrid cloud rather. And private cloud is for those enterprises who were still security conscious and do not want to openly put all their applications on the cloud, so which gave them a leeway where you can have everything like an in-house but not in their own premises. So from the cloud adoption perspective, this has really changed, and there are some studies, there are some research papers published by Cisco, which says that by 2021, 94% of the workloads would be pushed onto the public cloud. Only 6% would remain on the traditional data centers. So such is the adoption from 2016 to 2021. In the five-year span, the rapid adoption of public cloud will see a huge growth. And I think this is going to be the future. And cloud is definitely going to stay. And of course, security concerns. No security is 100% foolproof, but yes, having said that, a lot of security measures are being taken care of, and with the transactions that we do on our banking transactions today, we should always remember that they're also on cloud. So when we think to migrate our enterprise applications onto the cloud, we think twice, but whenever we are swiping our credit card or a bank debit card, it's passing through some cloud infrastructure. So when that can be safe, I think we can be just assured that our data will also be safe. Thank you.
So I have one question for you. Like in terms of migration, like as you mentioned, like, you know, the percentage who are moving to cloud and the traditional that will be remaining. So what should be the key pointers that should be in mind of a CIO when they are migrating their platform from in-house traditional data center to a cloud-based data center?
The key pointers for any CIO to migrate to cloud and where should be at least three top migration points would be, one is we should have a very clear migration policy, strategy rather, defined strategy as to discuss with the business, chalk out a plan and see what can be moved to the cloud. And it should not start with the core applications. It should be the regular applications which can be migrated to the cloud and which require a huge amount of compute, storage, all these spaces, for example, email, HRMS software, because HRMS softwares grow as your employee strength grows.
Right.
So you require more speed, more performance, and more flexibility on that. Same as CRM or your email. So email storage is becoming a big headache because normally it is on the Exchange, still native Exchange databases, which consume a lot of space. So these things start telling the business that, yes, these are the non-core applications, and we keep the core applications within the premises. The second is the licensing part. When we are changing from our on-prem to a cloud model, we have to ensure that what will happen to our existing licenses,
right.
Find out the licensing policies, whether these licenses can be moved onto the cloud or we need to purchase additional licenses. So a definitive plan has to be chalked out as to keeping the cost protected of the existing licenses, how do we move them onto the cloud.
Right.
And the last end is the agility. Start small. You have to start, as I said, you have to start with small applications, get the business to get used to it, derive the benefits, the accessibility part, performance, and then scale up the core applications or major applications.
Right. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. My views are a little more practical. I will try to give one example on this thing. See, the majority of the cloud adoption is that, let us take understanding is that we have close to 7-8 different areas within the organization. Talk about your networking, going to your operating systems, virtualization, middleware, your storage component, then you're coming to the middleware applications and the data. The buzzword is that the data is exponentially moving very fast. So every organization, they have one common question is the security and the compliance. The security is very, very important. I think it should be, one should have a continuous security strategy in terms of moving to the cloud. So there are multiple news in the market, whether you see the Google it, look for the Forbes.com, you'll see that 70-80% of the SMBs, they have moved to the cloud by starting with one application, testing their comfort. So what is more important here is that you need to have your fixed policies and internal process, because that is more important. You move to the cloud, your people has to handle it. So the culture is important. So they will have a lot of resistance in terms of acceptance, because when you move to the cloud, the major resistance will come from the IT administrator, the IT team, because they don't understand the board level discussions. The board would like to have the cost reduction. That's the main challenge. So if you want to think about cost reduction, they are directly, indirectly, they are prepared that they may have initial boost of investment. But as the technology is moving faster, they need to match the footsteps. That, okay, I need to go ahead to the cloud. Cloud is really having a lot of advantages. That's really right. But if you think of the perspective, like when you're moving it, you have to think all these parameters in terms of security. Make your security such a continuous strategic stronger, which is matching to your inside policies process, and I'm sure the technology will make a fitment automatically. Do not be too much dependent onto the vendors. Okay, you need to have some kind of a parallel vendor governance policies in place. Why I'm lying to insist here is that vendor is not having any knowledge about your inside business secrets, inside policies. So by keeping these pointers, the important is he is interested in selling his security tools. What is important for you is to manage your security. If your security is stronger enough, I think you are very near to the compliance. And definitely, at least in India, the compliance is slowly getting stronger as the digital innovation is taking place. So keeping this in mind, there are a lot of security pointers we need to take place, identity access management, then at storage levels, then at user levels, and the networking speed. You need to follow again your policies, process, and see how you can increase the speed. Try to adopt some kind of applications available in market which can compress your data, and automatically your speed increases, and it gives you the availability to operate from your any device, and parallelly making sure that the security is in place. Like, it's a really endless discussion. It can really take a longer if someone has to discuss in depth. So I would really stop here stating that we need to embrace this paradigm shift in the technology as the cloud is progressing ahead.
All right.
Thank you.
So I have one question for you. Is that like, Prasad sir also mentioned that, about having policy in place. But then at times what happens is, how do you go about defining that? So what are your suggestions or advice on defining the policy for your organization?
Okay. Defining the policy, like, first thing is that I will tell you practically, like, take your team into comfort. You know the business process, like, one part. Second part is that people are being influenced by the different departments. Okay. So you need to respect that and understand. Once you understand, you are in the position to set down a policy and put it on the board and make it as a corporate strategy. Once you make it as a corporate policy, I think it becomes kind of a benchmark or ruler to follow, everyone to make it follow. So that is more important in terms of the policies. And policy in this digital innovation, you cannot fix it. You need to keep on reviving it, changing it as per the incidents happening, as per the issues happening. What you need to take care of is the business process, business reputation, business revenue, and your customers. Because these are the three important things where even cloud service provider will not take care. Cloud is, they are a service provider. They are making the best of the platforms available to you. So if you take care of the security, you are automatically moving towards compliance set by the regulatory authorities, set doing by the government organizations. So that way your policy comes into the place. And it has to be continuous. It cannot be an yearly format.
Right.
You need to have a consistent, continuous changes happening, and not only that, making awareness, making the training to the people. I will share one incident, if you can allow me. It was not of a completely cloud, but it was of a networking speed. And we happened to sign up the SLA contract with the vendor and trusted them. So after getting everything in place, we've gone through level of discussions, got the maker-checker assembly. I'm like, why maker-checker is getting the audit team into confidence that finance point of view, everything is right. And other part is getting the admin team also, because admin is the directive to take care of the operations, to take care of the security. Now I'm saying security, physical security also plays a role. We are going through security, we are trying to talk about security. The security can come from many corners. Okay, the people are very much reflective. You cannot guess any kind of a hurt. They may try to do some kind of a action, and that can be a damage to the organization. So let's say you take care of an APT attacks, like advanced persistent threats. Someone brings a USB drive. How do you detect he is bringing? Because the USB drives are coming in a chip level, micro level. So there was an incident I asked about security, and he was reluctant. He was resistant. Why should I check the people whether he is carrying a USB drive or not? But I was thinking in organization perspective, and admin was thinking in a people's perspective. So these are the challenges everyone is coming across. So with these vendors, coming back to the reality, the vendor has delivered the MPLS network, and we were having a plan to go along with an SD-WAN. This vendor has delivered the network properly, but when the incident started repeating, so I took, it is very imperative, one has to really take the 2-3 incidents just for an organization point of view. So after repetition of 2-3 incidents, I stepped into the reality. I said, where, why, what? So my head office, I'd gone outside, and there was near about 700 meters, the defaults were repeated. When I'd seen actually, I captured that information. The problem was fixed, but I narrated to the management of the service provider. And what has happened? The rectification took place, but something new came out. And the problem was that they promised to give the head office the loop circuit. I'm like, if one loop fails, you get connection to that. But the 750 meters, it was a single last mile.
Right.
Correct. So these are sometimes the challenges. They have delivered, but they have not communicated. So that helps us to redefine the SLAs and think in terms of the in terms of your organization benefit, right, in terms of long perspective or maybe redefining SLAs. So such multiple incidences keeps on coming. You have to take it on a, sometimes at micro levels, and that micro levels helps you to redefine your policies again.
Correct.
Okay, so these are incidents where it can help you in terms of having the a good uptime or your downtime gets reduced. But then here you have to really put on your footsteps, maybe sometimes go into the field and have an inspection, like get outside your cabin. Okay, so that will really help you.
Right.
Like, these are a lot of incidents I can share you in the next questions.
Yes, sure.
Thank you.
Yeah, please.
Coming to this, how to define a policy is also sometimes can be on a situation based or on a pain point based. For example, in my example, I can give you for a backup policy. Normally, traditional backups or the core system backups are always in-house. You have an in-house data center, you have an in-house backup on a tape or a storage or a tapes. We have a very large sales force, 450 plus people traveling all over the country, not coming to offices. But they store all their critical data on the local disks of the laptops, and they feel IT is the god, and whenever my laptop crashes, I will get my data as it is. And the cases have happened that people's hard disk crashed and we were not able to give because they don't come to offices. They operate some places where we do not have offices because we cannot be present in all the cities in the country. So this was a big challenge, and they used to come and say that, what do we do if the laptop crashes? So then it became a case study for me to push. We are a German company, globally mandated by certain standards, and cloud was a big no till 5 years back.
Okay.
So I had to take it as a case study and put it up to them and tell the German global team that we need to think of pushing the endpoint backup onto the cloud.
Correct.
There is no point in getting asking them to come to office. They don't understand the realities or the practicals. In Germany, maybe people come to, sales guys also come to office every day, but that cannot happen in India.
Right.
So I made a case study. I made it as a business case, put up the pain points, identified a solution, and told them that what is the data that is going to be stored on the cloud, which is not at all a critical data, their email data, their regular doc files, Excel files, and some customer communications. So this became a policy.
Correct.
This was rolled out, and now it is a policy across the organization that any endpoint backup, the product was identified, it became a global template.
Right.
Now every country, whoever has a sales team, will use this product as a global endpoint backup. So for endpoint backup. So policies can be made based on your needs. It cannot be a master policy. You don't have to sit one full day and say that this will be my global strategy for cloud. Take it as it comes. That's what is the approach.
Okay. So my take on cloud data centers is you need to really assess yourself practically, and depending upon your business scenarios, you need to take a call, okay, whether you have to move to cloud or do you want to stay on-prem. Okay, I'll just give you some couple of examples in our business scenarios. Okay, so majority of our customers are based out of North America. Okay, and we also have set up some nearshore ODCs where our customers are. Okay, now we are into pure play engineering R&D and engineering services. Okay, so we do a lot of design work. Okay. Now, if I have to bring all this data back to our data centers in India, okay, process them and send it back, okay, it's a huge traffic, and there's a latency also, okay. So, do we need something like edge computing or edge data centers, mm-hmm. which are very close to our offshore ODCs, where the people can connect and work, right? Okay, and these days people work from any place, any device, any time, right? So we have to think about that also, okay? And when we are giving them all such provisions to work from anywhere, any device, it could be a trusted device, it could be a non-trusted device, okay? And every design is an IP. It needs to be protected, right? So when you are providing a solution or you are setting up a data center or you are going with an HCI near shore ODCs or cloud, okay, security has to be implemented as part of design. Okay?
Right.
So that is what we do. okay, be it an application or a infra, okay, which we are setting up, okay, it is part of design that security needs to be considered, okay. And I agree with both Sunil and Prasad also, okay, you cannot have policies just defined like that. It totally depends upon the need, use cases, and depending upon the scenarios, you will have to review your policies and keep modifying it.
Correct.
Okay, so that's the key for it.
Nice, okay. Way to round it up.
Yeah.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah. Hi, I'm Mukesh Mehta, CTO at B&K Securities. I have different view little, how, like we need to go into a little bit of history, last few years, how the things have changed. So when you talk about cloud, it started in 2013, 14, it matured in, say, 15 and 16. So today, almost all CIOs, all the business are on cloud. So let's not discuss the advantage and the points of the cloud. Now we are in the cloud. We are now facing the challenges and the problems of the cloud, actually. So the advantage are the gone days. Like, so 15, 16, everybody was cloud. Then it comes 17, 18, 16, the digital, digital, digital. Now in last 6 months or 1 year, 18, 19, and 20, people are talking about AI, ML, and blockchain. So these are the last 6, 7 areas, next 2 years we have. So when we come to cloud, let's not discuss the advantages in the cloud. Now we have more problems in the cloud. Everybody is facing the challenges, whether it's securities, whether it's interoperability, and many other things. And secondly, the more important point which I had noticed and which we had done a little bit, a lot of homework, not all things on the cloud are cheaper. They are actually, when you take a ROI for 3-4 years, actually it is more costlier than your on-prem. Only advantages, there are some advantages which it comes. Other than it is completely 4-5 years on the cloud is a ROI point of view, from a CFO desk point of view, it's a real challenge. The bigger challenge is from the technology perspective, which now we are facing, everybody's interoperability, the security portion, the data leakage, the data protection, the intercontinent, the local data, and the global data. Now the data policies, the data policy is coming, data privacy is coming. So they are the more challenges in the cloud rather than an advantage now in the cloud. So we need to be more discussing and more having our open sessions on the problem area. That is where we need to have more focus, actually.
Right. So as you said, like, you know, what you're kind of highlighting is like convergence is, instead of making convenience for customers, it's becoming pain point for CIOs.
Organizations also.
Right.
Because now the interoperability, when we moved some workload on cloud 3-4 years back, now if I want to, that vendor or that company is not performing, or the 4 years back, the cost was seriously high. Today the cloud is become a commodity. So if I want to move from one vendor to another vendor, the interoperability and the other challenges are really a big problems now. It's not an easy takeaway for any CIO or any organization. You don't know whether data will go. So they are 4 years back, 5 years back, they were not so big SLAs, not so the legal point of view about data. Today people are talking about data production, data everywhere. 5 years back, there was not so big on the data. Today we are having a serious problem when we are planning to move from one place to another vendor. And now with the Data Privacy Act coming in 2019, I don't think it will go into this Lok Sabha session, but it will be in 2019. You have to bring whatever cloud is into India. So then there is a challenge, actually. Somebody has a few GBs of data, somebody has a few TBs of data, somebody has Zetas, Petas. So it is not so easy going to happen, and then there's a cost will be implemented. So entire thing, if you go from ROI point of view, it will be a serious challenges now.
So are you still recommending that we have an on-premise or an in-house
system? The core will be remain on the on-prem. The core products that, like it is in the banking or like I'm from capital market, the trading platform will always be on-premise. It cannot be because of latency and because of other workloads. But otherwise, the long runs, the support systems like HRM or CRM or your reimbursements and all those support application can continue to be there. But again, then you need to be very clear what is the cost to survive for 5 years. The best portion is that you have a OPEX-based model with the vendor, which comes with the bundle software. So if you want to have your own software, own applications, own workload, and then you put it on the cloud, you are paying to the vendor also, the cloud vendor also. ROI goes for toss actually.
Right.
So that's, we need to be more cautious and more worried about what is going on the down the road actually. Like the security, what three people have already discussed. There is a serious challenge about the security. We don't know what is what they are doing, how much mature they are, what tools they are using to safeguard our data. Right. They don't provide on SLA, they don't provide on the document. You can ask any CIO in the room, do any vendor provide what software they are using for security? No.
I think Mr. Venu Gopal would like to comment on that.
Yeah, we have.
Let's hear his thoughts.
Can I share my thoughts? Hello. What Mukesh says is absolutely right. I have one incident, like this is really practical, cannot disclose the name of the service provider. The real incident was that there was something like all of a sudden everything monitoring tools were in place and nothing was identified. But that doesn't mean that they're doing 100% monitoring, okay. Otherwise this event could have been happened. The event what has happened, at one instant, the whole database server collapsed. Okay. And a bunch of customers in that particular group, they got really affected because it's a business time and things were running out of control. So when we drilled down and found out, it took 3 hours to really find it out which server has gone down and why. So we, in that 3 hours, the team has pushed that customers to the other server because that was a temporary shift. Now, this was a big challenge. I'm trying to support the Mukesh question. That these are challenges where the database size is so high that when that particular customer got annoyed, he wanted to move out. And that kind of size of database, I'm like moving onto the spinning disk is practically really like unthinkable. Let's not go into the depth. So they compromised, okay, give us a better solution and moved ahead. So it took another 3 months to really practically find it out that what was problem within that server. And I had very closely seen the top giants who supplied the servers. They sent X team, Y team, Z team. And I was not the particularly into that particular basket to really immediately take the decision. I was an observant. But when the situation came, I told my immediate boss, I said, there is no conclusion. Would you allow me to do some kind of my remarks? And I gave my remarks. The problem was really at a basic level, when I'd gone nearer and inspected, the exhaust fans, you know, you must be aware, every server has exhaust fans. The exhaust fans were running slower. And everyone moving around, someone said air conditioning problem, someone said ventilation problem. And these are the real challenges of the people one has to understand. And when you're going through these things, the cost is going to impact. The business is getting impact. And it is difficult to move ahead. But again, my mind says that why the cloud is moving faster is that today the way IoT has come into the picture, the data is getting so much generated. So we have got two data, structured data, unstructured data. And that is where our lot of team has conveyed in the previous discussion, the AI is playing a really big role. Absolutely right, but it's going to really play a big role in terms of giving you some kind of a dynamics of what is that unstructured data and what is speaking about. And it may help you to take some decisions. So one side you have benefit, other side you need to really be, I think you should do a micromanagement because you cannot quit. Your ROI is at a stake. And I'm sure by some ways you can really control the cost and bring down.
Correct.
But again, ROI is a challenge.
Correct. Yeah. I'll just come back to you. Let's hear his comments on very critical point raised by Mukesh.
Yeah, I think that was a very crucial point that he raised as well. Before trying to answer what Mr. Mukesh said, I just want to say that, you know, our cloud business, our cloud security business in India is growing in triple digits year on year, right? Which means that something good is happening in terms of business for us, and then also in terms of customers moving data to the cloud. Otherwise, we don't see the possibility for us to go in triple digits, one. The second thing is about the SLAs. I think there are two aspects to cloud security, like I said at the start. If you go to the public cloud vendors or if you go to the private cloud vendors, there is one aspect of security that they guarantee. And then there is one aspect of security that cyber security companies like us guarantee, right? And then, nobody can stand and say that it is foolproof, right? it is the same that we were talking about in the network world.
Correct.
It is the same in the cloud world. Nobody can put their head on the block and say that, okay, my security is going to be foolproof. That's not going to happen. What we're saying is that every single vendor will tell you that they have the best technology. Obviously, all of you would evaluate which is the best before you take a decision. But then, if we have to put our skin in the game and tell that, yes, install Checkpoint, nothing's going to happen to you, that's not going to happen with any other vendor. In terms of the SLA, again, you're right, sir. It is not easy for an SLA to come from the vendor of the cloud service provider or from the cybersecurity vendor, because there are certain aspects which kind of fall under both the layers, right? So that is one thing. The second thing is a lot of user awareness is also needed in terms of moving to the cloud. I'll give you an example. I was actually discussing with a customer right here in Mumbai, obviously I can't take the name, about cloud security. They had moved a bunch of apps to the cloud. And while we were having the discussion with their DevOps team, one of the gentlemen there was not able to access the database on the cloud. So what would you expect the person would do? Call the support center of the particular database provider and ask him to look at the ticket that the person is logged. On the other side of the phone, the guy who's actually looking into the ticket asked for the admin login and password to log into the cloud database. And they just give it on the phone, right? So is there some sort of awareness that is mentioned or that is created in the organization? I think that is something we all need to look at as well. What we say is there needs to be a way in which the support guy gets access to your database without you having to actually give out your username and password. Right? There should be a mechanism where a remote channel is established securely for a specific time window, after which that's just removed. So, yes, going back to what you said, there are certain things that we can sign up for an SLA. There are certain things we cannot sign up and say that cloud security is, you know.
I think that is the pain area. Yes, can we have Arjit, please?
Yeah. Good afternoon. I'm Arjit Mitra, and I'm from Noida Power Company Limited. So Noida Power Company is into electricity distribution, and I can offer quite a different take on the challenges of adoption, cloud adoption. So the electricity distribution sector, as you may be very well aware, is a heavily regulated sector. And the way the businesses in this sector are run is, even though we are a privately managed company, the business model is almost that of a government company, where the company is actually rewarded for building assets or capital assets. And hence, the business model is more capex focused and opex averse. OPEX is basically perceived as a way or as an indicator or a barometer of the efficiency of maintaining assets. So in case the OPEX goes up, then the company is deemed to be inefficient, and accordingly the company suffers. So in our scenario, what we find is that we have to choose our cloud solutions very carefully. We normally adopt cloud solutions only when there is no viable on-prem option, or the option that is available on-premises is an inferior option. And only when the cloud solution actually offers a significant competitive advantage that we cannot ignore is when we go ahead and adopt the cloud. So here we find that when it comes to building assets, you know, very recently we have decided to construct our own data center. We have not gone in for hosting on the cloud. Driven more, I mean, there are many issues that have been talked about so far as cloud adoption is concerned, but we were driven more by our financial model. And but what we see is there is also a growing trend that we can see for ourselves. This model that we are pursuing, although it is driven by regulations, but in terms of IT adoption, this is not a sustainable model. In the sense that what we see is that the cloud services are obviously much more profitable. Anybody who is providing an on-premise option for the CIOs, it is definitely, or the CFOs, it is definitely more profitable if you are sticking with the solution for more than 3 years. And for the service provider, it is obviously more profitable if you can draw the customer out to the cloud. And from that perspective, we also see that the latest technologies, the best technologies, are often coming to the cloud first and then passed on sometimes to the on-prem options. So probably we are going to see a journey, an inexorable journey towards the cloud. And yes, there are many issues that exist today in so far as cloud adoption is concerned. But there is also a process of maturity of technologies. As we grapple with these challenges, we also discover the solutions. And the trend is that the solutions gravitate towards the more profitable models. So we'll probably see a need for us to also go back and present before the regulator so that the regulations also allow us more flexibility for cloud adoption.
Correct. So with this, I'll open the floor to our delegates in audience here. If you have any questions, please raise your hand. I'll get the mic over there. Anybody? I think we have a fairly comprehensive discussion then. So just to round it up, cloud definitely seems to be the future, but then there are a lot of pointers that our esteemed speakers pointed out. One is to have a policy, which is a framework which is has to be constantly reviewed and has to be constantly altered as per your business requirement, as per your technology requirement. Secondly, have a backup plan. Thirdly, have like the allocation of technology or probably resources has to be, as Mr. Sunil mentioned, like, you know, on demand basis, and it has to be a evolution and learning journey. So I think, yeah.
One point just to add to your discussion.
Yeah.
I think what we should acquire is a zero trust policy. Zero trust means you don't keep the trust. Your business is on stake. You always verify. Whatever the vendor says, verify. Each and every step, verify, verify, verify. I think, and with an encryption technology, one should be a winner.
Correct.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, please. Can we? Right there. Okay, we have one question coming.
Hi. Hi, my name is Subodh Gupta, I'm from Edelweiss. Just one question, because a lot of you use the cloud and data centers. Given the change towards mandatory moving the data to country, how does it impact your business? Have you guys, and maybe it can be answered by many other in the room, have you guys moved your, ensured that your data is now within India, or any movement towards thinking on that line?
Sandeep, will you answer? Or can you please repeat it slightly?
My question is, there is a regulation. One is on financial services, that in data for Indian guys have to stay in the country, right? As per the mandate from RBI. Well, there is, and general movement that the data for Indian companies, right, should preferably stay on Indian servers. Is that something which has impacted your business in any way? Or is that, you know, the decision making making you look at service providers only in India vis-a-vis going to cloud, say, overseas, Amazon, Microsoft, and so on? So,
actually, now with this, the Data Privacy Act and everything coming in 2019, almost all the big providers are already moving to India, whether it's Microsoft, whether it's Microsoft or AWS and everything, they are, even Alibaba and all those things, they are now in India. They have to be in India if they want to do the business, because data of India will remain in India. Now it's very clear. So it's the, rather than the CIOs or the companies, even the partner, the vendors or the OEMs or the partners, they are already prepared. They are, the agreements and everything is say this, the data center will be in that, whether it's they provide the location also, whether it's Pune, Hyderabad, in case of the other couple of people in the new which has come, or the Alibaba, all those things. I don't want to take the individual names. But now they are providing the data center name itself, the location. So they are very clear that this, oppose this Data Privacy Act, which is going to be in 2019. Everybody is prepared, the bullet points, people were, the Shri Krishna Ayog, the commission, people were aware what is on the board. Now people are closely aware. So now people are, in fact, now data privacy, they are, your data scores now will become a more bigger challenge actually. Right. Till now, as an individual, we were more concerned on CIBIL score. As a corporate, now data score, your data trust score is becoming a challenge. So people are now talking about that. And vendors are giving SLAs and talking about that also. So that is now available actually. That's not a new things which is not available or people are not doing it. Everybody is now in that way. In fact, your oath is 65. Now they are also saying that we have the entire things for the India by in India. So they have the Hyderabad and the Pune data center. So O365 themselves are saying, Google was there in India from almost 1.5-2 years, they are completely in India. So these are the 4-5 big players who are the global players who are there. And Indian data centers actually are giving a good competition. So I don't want to take the individual names, but we know they are giving a much tough competition on the pricing also and on the support and the service actually.
And just to add on what Mukesh has told, okay, in case your data is lying outside India, okay, so these cloud data center providers, they also do the migration of data from your outside India to inside. So tenant to tenant migration is also possible, be it just your infrastructure or as service or your SaaS based applications. So that tenant to tenant migration is also possible. So you have that as an option available.
Yeah. Any other question? Okay. So I would like to thank our esteemed panelists. I will request them to take their seats in the dais. Please. So we'll take a short tea break. We'll keep it for 5 to 10 minutes. And then we'll go on for the star awards that we are going out to today.